Well, if you're in your scripture tonight, if you brought your copy of God's Word, we're going to be in the first chapter of the book of Colossians tonight. I've been doing a Bible study for several months over in the Blue Room on Wednesday nights, and we've been in the book of John. I mean, that's been a wonderful time together, and I invite you to join us on Wednesday nights if you don't have anywhere to go after church supper at 6 o'clock in the Blue Room. We're over there and having a great time together. We call that Wednesday night prayer and Bible study, but we're studying the book of John. But tonight, what I want to do is I want to look at Colossians chapter 1, and we're going to look at verses 15 through verse 20. Paul writes this in Colossians 1:15. He writes these words: He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. Verse 17, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Verse 18, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. Verse 19 and 20, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Now, I'm going to come back and really hammer those verses in a few moments, but what I want to do is I want to begin to build an understanding of what it means to be under authority. In fact, if you're taking notes tonight, the name of the message or the Bible study is called Dealing with Authority. Now, some of you are thinking of your youth days. You were a junior high or a middle schooler or maybe a high school kid, and you were rebellious as the day is long, and you resisted authority, right? So some of you are resonating a little bit with, what does it mean to be under authority? Several months ago, some of you guys know that I used to run. You wouldn't be able to tell by now, but I was an avid jogger more than a runner, and I used to run in 5Ks and 10Ks and even did a half marathon. I almost died on that one, and really was really enjoying just kind of changing my life and trying to be more healthy, eating better, you know, the whole deal. Well, I started having some issues with my foot. They call that plantar fasciitis, okay? I'm not going to go into it, but it's not real fun. Heel pain is a better way to understand it. So I started thinking about, there's other forms of exercise that I can do to help my body be better. And so I started thinking about riding a bike. And so I went down to the store and I bought me one of those 14-speed, bikes with the handlebars that go like that, like a Tour de France, like cheap version of Tour de France bike. And the first thing my wife asked me when I got this bike, she goes, you know that you're supposed to wear a helmet, don't you? And I go, helmet? Man, those things are stupid looking, man. I'm not going to wear a helmet. What do I need a helmet for? And a little voice inside of me said, what are you, stupid? You better get a helmet or else. So you know what I did tonight? I brought my helmet with me. And I'm going to put it on. This is my helmet. It is the dorkiest thing that I could wear in front of you guys, okay? I'm putting my helmet on, and I'm going to strap myself in. And please don't take pictures and put this on social media, okay? What do you guys think? Okay, good, stupid, dumb, okay, whatever, okay. Yeah. There are times, and don't worry, I'm not going to keep this on the whole time, okay? There are times when I don't want to wear my helmet, all right? Because it gets hot out there in Pensacola, even in the morning with the humidity and the heat, and I want to take this helmet and just chuck it as far as I can chuck it. But then there are other times when I'm riding my bike, When the traffic is a little crazy, like on 9 Mile Road, like on Highway 29. I mean, I rode over to Chet Seafood yesterday morning in Pace from where I live in Cantonment, okay? Went over the bridge a couple of times, you know. There are times when you want that helmet on your head because of the protection that it gives. Well, in kind of a weird, stupid kind of a way, this bicycle helmet represents being under authority. You know, there are times when being under authority just doesn't seem to fit. Like, Lord, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do what that guy says. Or, Lord, I don't, what he's asking me or what she's asking me to do, Lord, isn't convenient. But then there are other times in your life when things get a little hairy, right? And then you're going down the 9 Mile Road of your life or the 29 of your life or the Pace Bridge of your life. And you're thanking Jesus that you're under God's authority. I'm going to take my helmet off because I'm getting hot under my helmet over here. But this helmet, in a kind of a silly kind of a way, it represents being under authority. Because there's different things about authority that are really important. The main thing about authority is that when you're under authority, you're protected. You see, you're supposed to be where you're supposed to be. And so tonight what I want to do is I want to look at authority, and I want to see what authority looks like under the ministry and the life of Jesus. Now, if you look at Scripture, look at John chapter 8, verse 28, and it should be on the screen. Sharon was gracious enough to throw this together for me at the last minute tonight. But John 8, 28 says this, "So Jesus said to them, 'When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me.'" I think one of the things that we need to really understand about authority tonight is this. You can just jot this down. Jesus operated under the authority of God. We're not talking about Paul the Apostle. We're not talking about Peter. We're not talking about Moses. We're not talking about Elijah. We're talking about the Son of God. But yet Jesus understood what it meant to operate under the authority of God. Look at verse 28 again in John 8. "So Jesus said to them, 'When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me.'" The Lord understood what it meant to operate under authority. He didn't do anything apart from the command and the direction and the teaching of His Heavenly Father while He was on the earth. We have a hard time probably trying to understand that relationship between Jesus the Son and God the Father, because we know in Scripture that Jesus is God. He wasn't just a good man. He wasn't just a nice prophet. He wasn't a great teacher. He was God in the flesh. But yet God in the flesh understood what it meant to be under authority. Jesus said it right here in our text. I don't do anything unless I do it under the authority of the Heavenly Father. So what's the implication for you and for me? Well, let me ask you a question tonight. Are you operating under the authority of God? You know, when you go and make a big decision at work, or you make a decision to do something that's going to change the direction of you or your family, are you under the authority of God when you're making that decision? Or maybe, just maybe, you're just kind of pulling out the old gun and making a shot from the hip and going, "I hope God's going to bless this decision." Bang. But you see, Jesus understood what it meant to operate under the authority of God. Another thought real quickly here to help us build a case for being under the authority of God is this one. Jesus knew freedom under the authority of God. Now we turn to John chapter 10, look at verse 18. Look at John 10, verse 18. Jesus said, "No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father." Not only does Jesus understand how to be under authority or operate under authority, but he also knew freedom under authority. Freedom to do what? Freedom to give up his life and to take his life back up again. Some people believe that Jesus, when he died on the cross, didn't have any choice there. But Christ willingly laid down his life on the cross, and he gave his life up. It wasn't the cross that was led to his demise. It was Jesus gave up his spirit. Because why? Because God gave him the authority to do so. See, one of the things we as Christians don't understand is that we think that if we get under the authority of God, we lose our freedom. I wonder who's behind that thought. It's not God. Who is it? It's our enemy. The enemy wants you to believe, dude, are you serious? You're gonna do that for God? Do you know what's gonna happen if you do that for God? You're gonna lose a lot. What are you, nuts? What are you, stupid? What are you, moron? That's what the enemy is telling us. The enemy is saying, man, if you go over there and do that for the Lord, you're going to lose a lot. But you see, in reality, if I don't do what God tells me to do and I don't get under authority, then I will lose a lot. Because why? Because when I operate out from underneath God's authority and protection, I'm at the open attack of the enemy. That's what Satan wants. He wants us to get out from under the authority of God. He wants us to be out there like prey without any protection, without any cover, without any defense. And that's what happens when people like you and I don't get under God's authority. We don't know freedom. See, when you're out from underneath God's authority, you become a slave to what the world wants. You become a slave to what the devil wants. You become a slave to what your flesh wants. This bicycle helmet might be a little burdensome sometimes. It might be a little bit uncomfortable. But let me tell you something. If I get into some kind of a wreck or I fall off my bike, my head is going to be protected from this dumb-looking helmet. But if I decide to fling it off one day, I'm just going to go without the helmet, then I could have some serious head injuries if I fall off my bike or crash. So when we're under authority of God, we know the freedom that there is under the authority of God. And then one more thought here before we get into Colossians. Turn over to the book of Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8, and I want us to look at a few verses here, verses 5 through 9. And of course, this is the famous dialogue that Jesus had with the centurion, right? Matthew chapter 8, verses 5. When he had entered Capernaum, a centurion came forward to him, appealing to him, "Lord," verse 6, "my servant is lying paralyzed at home, suffering terribly." And he said to him, "I will come and heal him," Jesus said. But the centurion replied, "Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I too am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. And I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. You see, Jesus not only operated under the authority of God, Jesus not only knew freedom under the authority of God, but Jesus expects us to be under the authority of God. It's not some type of nice advice or, you know, a nugget of wisdom or an opinion, but God wants us to be under the authority of the Lord. And even a Roman centurion understood the concept of authority. He said, Lord, I don't need you to go anywhere or be anywhere near my servant that's lying paralyzed and ill. All you have to do is say the word, and he'll be healed. Because I'm a man under authority, and I understand what it means. If you tell somebody to do something, they're going to do it. And so, Lord, I'm not here to inconvenience you. I'm not here to put you out. I just simply want you to help me by telling or doing whatever it is that you do, be healed. And I know it'll happen. And of course, later on, if you keep reading the scripture, Jesus is amazed at such faith coming from a Roman centurion, a non-Jew, a Gentile. Well, you're sitting here tonight and you're asking yourself the question, what does it mean to be under the authority of Christ? What does that, you know, what does that look like? What does that smell like? What does that feel like? How does that work? To be under the authority of the Lord. Well, we go back and we look at Colossians. Because this passage of Scripture paints a beautiful, precise picture of how glorious and how awesome and how wonderful Jesus really is. And in Colossians chapter 1, verses 15, we see the first verse right here. And this is one of my favorite verses of Scripture. Paul writes to the Colossians in verse 15, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. So what I want to do here is I want to give you four or five things about the authority of Christ. Number one, if you're taking notes, number one would be this. Christ's authority is a reflection of God. Christ's authority is a reflection of God. Both of my children have a tattoo on their body. One of them has more than one. The other one has one. And that's not something that my generation embraces, the tattoo, right? But my kids' generation embraces the tattoo. So I always tell my kids, because they want me to get one really bad. You know, Dad, it would be so cool if you get a tattoo. And I go, I'm not getting a tattoo. But if I ever got a tattoo, and I'm telling you, I'm not going to get one, okay? But unless the Lord comes to me tonight in a vision, I'm not getting one, okay? Because they hurt, buddy, okay? But if I ever got a tattoo, it'd be Colossians 1:15. It's my favorite verse. For he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. In my mind, in my heart, that sums up perfectly who Jesus Christ really is. Like I said earlier in the evening, he's not a good teacher. He's not just a prophet. He's not just a great man. He is God. And it sums up perfectly who Jesus really is. He is God, and he is preeminent above all else. The authority of Jesus is really a reflection of who God really is. I mean, if you think about it, if he is the image of the invisible God, what does that mean for you and for me? If Jesus is the image of the invisible God, what does that mean for us? Well, it means that Jesus is somebody that you could reach out and touch. He's somebody that you could have a conversation with. He's somebody that you could laugh with. He's somebody that you could sit down and have a meal with. Because he's the image of the invisible God. We know that God the Father is Spirit, and we know that the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God, but Jesus has a body. He got it when he resurrected from the dead. And one day, we're going to get a body like Jesus. I don't know what it's going to look like. I don't know if I'm going to have a six-pack or not. You know, I don't know what that's going to look like, but I'm going to have a body that's going to be eternal. It's never going to break down. It's never going to get a fever. It's never going to get sick. It's going to be an eternal body. And so Jesus came out of the glory of heaven and put everything aside, and he walked on this earth for 33 years. And if people saw Jesus, they saw God. And that's why it's important that you and I read the scripture and study about the life of Jesus. Because everything that Jesus did is an example for you and for me, that we should be like Christ. Not be like Paul, not be like Peter, not be like Moses, not be like Elijah, but that we would be like Christ. So the first thing about the authority of Christ is that it is literally a reflection of God. Second thing I want to tell you about the authority of Christ is this, number two, Christ's authority is unlimited. Christ's authority is unlimited. Look at verse 16 in Colossians 1. Paul writes, "For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him." If you've been to one of my Bible studies, you know that I love to go outside at night and look up and see the stars up in the galaxy. And I'm just amazed at how vast and how wonderful and beautiful the universe is. And the stars, and if you took the Big Dipper constellation, right? It's the only one that I really know what it looks like, because the rest of them, I think they just kind of make it up as they go, because they don't look like a bull, but anyway, whatever. But the Big Dipper looks like the Big Dipper, right? But if you were to get in a spaceship and travel just from one of those stars to the next star that makes up the Big Dipper, you know how long it would take you to get to the next star? I mean, we don't have time to figure it out, okay? It's a long time. You know, pack your lunch, okay? You see what I'm saying? And that's just one star from point A to point B that would take you hundreds and hundreds of years to probably get to each star. And yet Jesus Christ made that. And I'm talking about two stars, but there's millions and millions and billions of planetary and stars and heavenly bodies out there that Jesus Christ created. But, you know, if you want to bring it home, look at the earth. Look at the Grand Canyon. Look at the mountains, the beaches, the deserts, the forests, all over this beautiful creation. Jesus created all that. But not only did he create the universe and the planets and all that, but it also says that he is over thrones, dominions, rulers, or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. That means the government of the United States is under the authority of Jesus Christ. Sometimes we don't feel like it is. Things are a little weird right now, right, in America. But Jesus is over that authority. He's over that government. He's over those dominions, those rulers, those governors, those presidents, those leaders. So the authority of Christ is not only a reflection of God, but it's unlimited. Not only in its scope, not only in its power, but in its majesty. That's Christ, the authority of Christ. Third thing about the authority of Christ is this. Christ's authority is omnipresent. Christ's authority is omnipresent. Colossians 1:17 says this, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Now, I went to college and seminary, but it's been a long time, man. So I went back and I looked up the word omnipresent. And it basically means to be universal, to be everywhere. So Christ's authority is universal, and it's everywhere. I don't think we have any high school kids here in the building right now, but if we did, I would tell them that when they go to school this week or next week, Jesus Christ is there in authority. When you go to work tomorrow, whatever you do in your job, I don't care if you work for Gulf Power or ECUA or whatever, or deliver the mail, wherever you go to work tomorrow, Jesus Christ is an authority there. I know where I go to work, okay, he's an authority here as well. But he's an authority here just as much as he's an authority at the post office, at the mall, or wherever you might work. And then, of course, where you live, in your neighborhood, where you shop your groceries, wherever you go for whatever you need, everywhere you go, Christ's authority is everywhere. It's omnipresent. And I love what it says at the end of verse 17. And Paul writes this phrase, and in him all things hold together. And I think about that verse a lot, and I try to picture in my mind, what does that mean? That in him all things hold together. And it's kind of like Jesus is the supernatural glue, right? He's the glue. He's what keeps everything going, operating, nature, everything that we know. Jesus is holding it together. But not only is he holding nature together, he's holding you together. He's holding me together. Even when your life seems out of control and you've made a wrong turn and you've made a stupid decision and you don't know, Lord, what am I going to do now? I want to tell you something. Christ holds all things together. Really, when you think about it, it's a verse of scripture that makes Romans 8:28 possible. You know Romans 8:28? Anybody want to quote it for me tonight? Anybody? Romans, or at least read it from your scripture. Romans 8:28. I'll give you a hint. It starts out, for God causes all things to work for the good. For those who love him and are called according to his purpose. You know what that verse means? It means that no matter what you do or whatever happens to you, whether it's your fault or not your fault, Jesus comes along and makes it work out for the good. And I know that most of us in here aren't planning to trash and ruin our lives tomorrow by making stupid decisions. I get it. I mean, most of us in this room, you know, we're the few, the proud, the Marines, but I mean, we're here, buddy, Sunday night, right? So most of us in this room aren't trying to figure out ways to completely blow our lives up, right? But things do happen to us, right? Things are going to happen. Things, events, activities that we have no control of over are going to come to us. And Romans 8:28 tells us that God takes everything that happens and works it out for the good. For those who love God and are called according to his purpose. So that means that the authority of Christ keeps it together. The authority of Christ is omnipresent. Then we see in verse 18 that Christ's authority is omniscient. It's omniscient. Christ's authority is omniscient. That's number four. Colossians 1:18. Paul says this, and he is the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. Here's another word that we don't use a whole lot, right? Omniscient, okay? Here's what omniscient means. Omniscient means all-knowing, all-seeing, eternally wise, beyond comprehension, God-knowing, God's wisdom, God's teaching. So we know from Scripture here that Jesus is the head of the body, okay? So what does that mean? Well, that means that not only is he the head of the body of Christ, but Jesus leads the global church. And when I mean global church, I mean every Christian on the planet. Every person in this world that has become born again in Christ by faith, Jesus leads every believer, whether they might live in Russia, Mexico, the United States, Rio de Janeiro, where the Olympics are going on right now. No matter where you might be in the world, if you're a Christian, Jesus is your leader. He's the head of your movement. And then we know that he leads the local church, right? Olive Baptist Church, although it's one of the larger local churches that you'll come into contact with, okay? He's the head of this church, okay? Now, we do have a fine, godly, awesome senior pastor, Dr. Ted Traylor, but Jesus is the head of the church. And pastor gets his marching orders from Jesus through prayer, through Bible study, and through counsel of wise people around him. But then on a very personal level, Jesus leads you and me daily. That's why being under the authority of Christ is so important, because Jesus is omniscient. His authority is omniscient. He is all-knowing. He is all-seeing. Now, let me tell you this. If Jesus is the head of the church, and he calls the shots, right? Then what is it that Jesus wants us to do as the church? Well, I'll give you a hint. It's called the Great Commission. In Matthew chapter 18 through 20, Jesus gathered his disciples and his followers together for one last exhortation and admonition, and he said to them, go ye therefore into the world and make disciples of all nations. Authority has been given unto me from heaven and earth. Make disciples, teaching them, baptizing them, and lo, I'm with you always to the end of the age. We as a church, Olive, we've been wrestling lately with discipleship. What does discipleship really look like? Is discipleship a class of people that meet in a connection group? Is discipleship something that you go to on a Wednesday night class? Is discipleship something that happens when you go to your home and have people come over for dinner and you talk about God's word? There's a lot of different ideas and thoughts and suggestions about what discipleship is. But I know this. We might not exactly have it down to a science yet, but we know this. Discipleship is key with Christ. Why do we know that? Well, he not only told us to do it, but he modeled it for 3 years. He had followers. He had disciples that he spent time with. Now, The little that I've been a Christian in my life, I got saved when I was about 8 years old, so I've been a Christian for a few years now, okay? Do the math, figure it out. Discipleship comes in different levels. It does look different in certain stages of your life. But if there's two things I could say about discipleship, it'd be this. According to Jesus, discipleship, number one, it needs to be intentional. Now, what do I mean by intentional? Well, discipleship is intentional when we, as a disciple of the Lord, look around for someone that we need to disciple. See, I think discipleship is more than just a class. I think discipleship is more than just going to a Bible study. I think discipleship is you looking for someone to disciple. That's radical. See, when we start doing that more, this church will be forever changed. You see, I'm in a facility that holds about 4,000 people, and what do we have tonight? A little bit less than that. But even as wonderful and beautiful as you guys are, I can't disciple you by just being here teaching God's word. Because here's the deal. What if you have a question? What if you don't understand something? What if you struggle with, what are you talking about the authority? You can't really raise your hand and ask a question. Even if you did, this is not the place or the time to ask a lot of questions, because this is kind of like a lecture. I hate to bring it down to brass tacks, but that's kind of what this is. Nothing bad about a lecture, but it's very limited on how powerful it can be discipling people. So I think discipleship, according to Jesus, I think it's intentional. That means that people at Olive Baptist that have a faith, that love the Lord, they might not know everything about the Word of God and know everything about Jesus, but they know enough to be dangerous. They know enough to what? To intentionally disciple another person. But the other thing about discipleship that I believe that Christ wants us to understand, that it's personal. Oh, this is where we miss it. See, discipleship is personal. It's kind of messy. You know, when you pray and you say, okay, Lord, show me somebody that you want me to disciple, that means that you get into their life. That means that you get to know them on a personal level. That means that you get to find out a little bit about their background. You see, when you show up to a class, you don't do that. You show up, you sit down, you take your notes, you say, okay, thank the Lord, praise the Lord. It's a good Bible study, and it's very helpful for you, and you leave. But there's not a lot of personal interaction. There's not a lot of personal touch. I've shared this story with the staff and a few people on Wednesday night, but I think it kind of brings it home. Discipleship is like buying a chainsaw at Home Depot. You get what I'm saying? You go to Home Depot, right? And you go, I need a chainsaw. So you get one. Here's the problem. If you don't know how to operate this chainsaw, you could be kind of dangerous. You could maybe cut your foot off, or you could cut somebody else's foot, right? So they're going to hold a class at Home Depot at how to work your chainsaw. Fantastic. I'm going to it, man. Here I go. So Saturday morning, I show up at 10 o'clock, and I'm sitting to the little, this is how you do your chainsaw class. And I learn a lot about my chainsaw. That's really great. And by the way, my chainsaw does come with an owner's manual, right? So I'm good. So I get an owner's manual, and I go to the little Home Depot class. I'm good. But what if? Just humor me here a second. What if somebody from Home Depot that worked at Home Depot that knew about chainsaws went home with you? and took some time out of their schedule and said, hey, I'm going to go home with you, and I'm going to show you how to work this chainsaw, what would you do? Really? You're going to leave your job and come home and help me figure out how to work the chainsaw? Yeah, if you don't mind. I'd be glad to do that. So you go home, and the guy gets the chainsaw out, and he goes over the manual, and he goes over this and that, and he shows you a few things. And before you know it, you know how to do this chainsaw so well that guess what? You could teach somebody else how to work that chainsaw. Because somebody took the time not just to tell you to read the manual, not just direct you to a class on how to work the chainsaw, but they went to your house and they said, here, take the ripcord, do this. Prime the engine, do this. You want to make sure that when you cut the limb, you angle it like this. And make sure you know, and do, okay, now you try it. And before you know it, you're a chainsaw maniac. And you know how to do that chainsaw. Well, discipleship is all like that. We have a manual, right? It's the Word of God. We provide classes, right? Here at Olive, we have discipleship classes. We have Sunday school class, connection group. We have all kinds of classes. But what if we as Olivites begin to pray and say, Lord Jesus, put somebody on my heart that I could go to them and show them how to work the Christian life by how I live and by what I know and by my experiences. And see the strategy is, as we do that more intentionally, more personally, what happens? People's lives get radically changed with the power of God. Classes are great. Reading the Word of God is important and needful for our Christian life. But whenever somebody can come alongside you and encourage you about what the Word says and encourage you to how to do this and how to do that spiritually, and you know that you've got somebody in your life that you can go to when you have a need spiritually, and they can help you and give you counsel and guidance, along with the preaching and along with the Bible study and along with the other classes that we provide here at Olive. It just takes discipleship to another level. And it makes it personal and it makes it intentional. And you see, that is part of Christ's authority. It is omniscient. Finally, number five, Christ's authority is able to change lives. We wrap it up in verses 19 through 20. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. You know what the real cool thing about Jesus' authority is? It's able to change your life. You see, we get all worried and bothered about getting under authority, right? Because if we get under authority, then somebody else is going to tell us how to live. Somebody else is going to tell us how we should do this. And somebody else is going to be our leader. But when you get under the authority of Jesus Christ, it changes lives. It has the authority to change lives. And that's why Christ came in the first place. Jesus came to be the atonement for our sins. He came to die on the cross and rise again so that we might what? Be changed. That we might take the gospel and share it with people around us so that they can be changed. Boy, I tell you, there's so many books out there about improving yourself and self-help, and if you do this, if you do that. But we all know, right, the only way that your life is going to be changed is under the authority of Jesus Christ. Real quickly, how do you get under the authority of Christ? It's very simple. Number one, you have to want to be under the authority of Christ. Tomorrow morning, I'm going to ride my bike, man. I'm calling it the Olive Route. I start out at my house, I pedal down to Olive Baptist, and I turn on Olive Road, and I go all the way down to Highway 29, past Walmart, back up to where I live. And I'm going to let you know something. I'm going to have my helmet on, right? I'm going to get under the authority and the protection of my helmet tomorrow morning when I get on my bike. So if you want to get under the authority of Christ, number one, you have to want to be under the authority of Christ. It has to be something that you desire. And then the second thing you've got to do is this. You have to be willing to let Jesus have his way in your life. That means that certain areas of your life that you control, you got to let Jesus have control. Things like your thought life, things like how you treat people, things like how you spend your time, your schedule, your everything. Everything that you do, you have to be willing to say, Lord Jesus, I desire for you to be, to be under your authority. And now, Lord, I give you freedom to control the things in my life. That's why I just spent all this time telling you how awesome the authority of Christ is. That you would be willing to trust him with your life. Well, if you desire to be under the authority of Christ, and then you place yourself under the authority of Christ, then what do you do next? It's very simple. It's like I tell my Wednesday night guys, you begin to walk with Christ daily. You begin to operate under the authority of Christ. And that's why it's important that you have your quiet time. That's why it's important that you're in the Word of God, that you're studying God's Word, because in the Word of God, it tells you what to do every day. That's why we have it. It's God's direction, owner's manual for us, that we might know the Word of God, that we might live the Word of God, apply the Word of God. What do you do if you decide to take that helmet off and toss it to the side and you're under the authority of yourself again? What do you do then? You know what you do? You stop. And you repent and you just confess to the Lord, Lord, I'm sorry, I've taken back the authority that I gave you and I've taken it upon myself. Lord, I simply, in humility, I just give it back to you. And God's not going to get ticked off, and you know, God's not going to send a thunderbolt down to hit you in the head. He's going to say, I love you, child, I forgive you, let's keep on going together. Let's work, let's walk together. See, our Heavenly Father loves us and wants what's best for us. And so he's more than willing to take us under his authority and help guide and lead and direct and make a way for you and for me.